welcome you all to the 2014 Bicknell Lecture. This annual lectureship was conceived and funded by Dr. William Bicknell over a decade ago for the purpose of engaging provocative speakers in the discussion of controversial topics. I'm confident that this year's edition of the Bicknell Lecture will more than fulfill Bill's expectations. Bill Bicknell served on the faculty at the BU School of Public Health for many years. After I became dean in 1992, I worked closely with him to establish a Department of International Health at the school, and Bill served as the founding chairman. So the recently renamed Department of Global Health at SPH has become a large and defining department in the school, and global health has become a major focus of Boston University, and Bill played a key role in all of that. Bill, who was a non-smoker, died from lung cancer in the summer of 2012. Not surprisingly, Bill approached his impending shuffle off this mortal coil with the same unique style that characterized all his endeavors, giving a memorable last lecture that still lives on YouTube. So I went on the web and I typed in Bill Bicknell YouTube, and up it popped. And for those of you who were there, you almost expect the side door to open and Bill to ride in on a segue. I wish that would happen, but you can still get a kick out of it on YouTube. I'm pleased that so many of Bill's friends and colleagues are here today to help us continue his commitment to the consideration of controversial topics. I'm especially pleased that Bill's widow, Jane Hale, is with us today. Jane, many thanks for the important role you played in supporting this Bicknell Lecture over the years. Last year's Bicknell Lecture, which involved a debate on weight and health, was part of our Spotlight on Obesity program, a two-year initiative to highlight and examine an issue of critical public health importance. Spotlight on Obesity successfully united students and faculty across departments and engaged them in thoughtful discussions. This fall, we begin a new Spotlight series, Spotlight on Mental Health. For the next 2 years, our Office of Public Health Practice will engage the SPH community in education, research, and practice efforts that address mental health from an interdisciplinary public health perspective. The link between mental health and substance use will clearly be part of these discussions. If you were able to pick it up, this is the flyer which has the next Spotlight event on mental health, and then a whole list of other events connected with the Spotlight series for the fall of 2014. All right. Gives me great pleasure at this time to turn the podium over to the moderator of this year's Bicknell Lecture, Martha Werler. Martha is the new chair of the Department of Epidemiology. She is a renowned perinatal and child epidemiologist and has done a lot of work on risks for birth defects of various types, working primarily with colleagues at the Sloan Center. We're very pleased that she agreed to be our new epidemiology chair, and I'm very pleased that she agreed to chair this contentious debate. Martha?
Thank you, Bob, for that introduction, and I must say I'm so pleased to have been invited to moderate this, what I call, humdinger of a debate topic. Should alcohol consumption be encouraged as part of a healthy lifestyle? We are lucky to have four distinguished speakers on this topic. They bring a lot of a breadth of experience researching various aspects of alcohol consumption, and they have also a real depth of opinion. This is sure to be a lively debate. We have Drs. Kurt Ellison and Lionel Tiger on the pro side, and Drs. Rich Sage and Tim Maney on the con side. I want to begin with introducing all four of them so as to not interrupt the flow of the debate as we hear from each speaker. So I'll start with Dr. Ellison, who is a professor of preventive medicine and epidemiology here at BUSM. He is a senior investigator in the Framingham Heart Study and has published extensively on genetic and environmental risk factors for cardiovascular disease. In 1994, he established the Institute on Lifestyle and Health, and in 2010, the International Scientific Forum on Alcohol Research, which evaluates reports on alcohol exposures and various health outcomes based on the expertise of dozens of scientists from a variety of fields, and then publishes critiques and summary statements on its website. Dr. Lionel Tiger is the Charles Darwin Professor Emeritus of Anthropology at Rutgers University. His research explores human behavior and institutions from an evolutionary perspective. He has published books and speaks regularly to wide bodies of audiences on topics that range from religion and neurophysiology, contraception and the decline of men, the biology of optimism, and of relevance for today, the human need for pleasure. Dr. Rich Sates is a professor and chair of community health sciences here at BUSPH and professor of internal medicine in the medical school. He is a primary care physician and educator in addictive medicine. He conducts research in and is an expert in early identification and intervention for unhealthy alcohol and drug use, and also on optimal care for people with addictions. He co-edited a leading textbook called Principles of Addiction Medicine and is editor of the journal Evidence-Based Medicine. And then we have Dr. Timothy Namey. He is an associate professor at both the Schools of Medicine and School of Public Health here. He has worked as a clinician for the U.S. Indian Health Service and as an epidemiologist for the CDC's alcohol team. His area of expertise is researching binge drinking and alcohol consumption among youth, and he is a principal investigator on studies of impacts of alcohol policies on behavior. So welcome to our panelists. The format for this debate will be to open with our primary proponent for healthy alcohol intake, which is Dr. Ellison. And then we'll have our primary opponent, Dr. Sates, and then back to the proposing opinion from Dr. Tiger, and then Dr. Namey gets the last formal word in the debate. We'll have each speaker come up to the podium to state their viewpoint, and then after Dr. Namey is finished, we'll have the four speakers come up to the stage for Q&A. So we'll have questions from you all, and I ask that you line up at the two microphones and state your name and to whom you pose your question. My job is to monitor time, so that includes the speakers, but also I ask that for you questioners that you keep your questions brief and that you speakers be as succinct as possible in your responses so that we can have as much interaction as possible in a relatively short time. We need to finish at 11:45 today because there is a class held in this space at noon. The lecture will be taped and will be posted on the SPH website hopefully by tomorrow. Lastly, since I am the debate moderator, I better state my potential biases on this issue. So first, I am known to enjoy my session ales and my hopped up pilsners and Knob Creek. But I also, perhaps like many of you here, have also seen alcohol have a big negative impact on the lives of persons who are very close to me. So I can see both sides of the issue. We'll see where I come out after the debate. So, Dr. Ellison.
Thank you very much, Martha. It's a pleasure to be here. You see the title, Should Alcohol Consumption Be Encouraged as Part of a Healthy Lifestyle? I mean, it's so obviously yes. But we'll try to defend it a little bit. First of all, I serve as the co-director of the International Scientific Forum on Alcohol Research, which is consisting of 41 international scientists who work in this field. And our goal is to provide scientifically sound and unbiased appraisals of the literature, and we publish our critiques on the forum website here at BU. Partial expenses for operating the forum's website up until recently have come from unrestricted donations to BU from associations and companies, including some in the beverage industry. They have no input into what papers we review, the discussions regarding the paper, and so forth. But I can be suspected of being pro-alcohol because I do have some funding, have had some funding from companies in the beverage industry, and I'm an alcohol consumer. I insist on having a glass of wine with my dinner every evening. But similarly to Martha, I can also be suspected of being anti-alcohol. I was brought up as a teetotaling Southern Baptist where alcohol was a sin. I've had a relative who's an alcoholic, and I too have worked in emergency rooms where the last thing you want to see is another drunk coming in with all kinds of problems. I've also had funding from NIH, and starting back in 1974, when the Framingham Heart Study released its earliest paper on the risk factors from coronary heart disease, they had four: high cholesterol, high blood pressure, smoking, and abstinence from alcohol. It was a major risk factor. NIH said, whoa, you cannot publish that. They made them remove all references to alcohol because they're afraid that it would increase the abuse in this country. And several other instances since then where any time something coming up that may show that alcohol prevents heart disease or otherwise good for you, that they've shut it down. But our challenge to get to the topic today, people live longer now, as you can look at the speakers on my side. and we're all vulnerable to the diseases of aging. So anything that we can do to lower the risk of myocardial infarction, of a stroke, diabetes, dementia, and osteoporosis could be a real, make a real contribution to public health. Luckily, we know how to do this. And it's not through a magic pill that Sherry just brought out of someone, or a new technique that for $2 million you can buy. It's from a healthy lifestyle. Our colleagues over at Harvard and many other people around the world have found that there are five components of a healthy lifestyle that lead to the people who live the longest and have the fewest problems with old age. Don't smoke, stay lean, exercise regularly, eat a healthy diet, and unless contraindicated, consume small amounts of alcohol on a regular basis. The problem has been that some people have questioned not smoking. We've never done a clinical trial of smoking. We've never done a clinical trial of obesity where we assign people to get fat or stay lean. But they said, well, wait a minute, we only have observational data for alcohol. So let's talk about that just a little bit. The best summary of the epidemiologic data was published in the BMJ in 11, ironically. And you'll notice that since 1980, we have a huge number of papers who relate moderate drinking, the risk of moderate drinkers, to non-drinkers in terms of coronary heart disease mortality. And it's been an amazingly consistent finding in every study, and even though the more recent ones say well, we only look at lifetime abstainers rather than make sure there are no ex-drinkers, it's very consistent. You can see that the overall estimate is about 25% lower risk. And from this, we get this familiar J-shaped curve. If you, these are selected studies that Correa summarized. There were 28 cohort studies that adjusted for previous drinking and other risk factors, smoking in particular. And you'll see in comparison with someone who is a non-drinker, zero alcohol, there's a decrease in the risk of coronary heart disease if you drink a little. And if you drink a lot, this is what, 5, 6, 7, 8 drinks a day, it gets up there. You see this J-shaped curve. But Rich is going to argue that, you know, these people who drink moderately also, you know, tend to be have other healthy lifestyle factors. You know, they tend to smoke less, exercise more, eat a healthy diet. So we're very lucky that we have studies such as this one by Ken Muckamal. This is the health professional study. There are about 10,000 people in this particular analysis looking at the risk of myocardial infarction. And these are the non-drinkers over here on the left. And you'll notice that if you have few or zero of these healthy lifestyle factors, non-smoking, non-obese, active and good diet, you have a very high risk. Whereas the people who have all four factors, these are the people down here, who are lean, good-looking, non-smokers, you know. These are the people, they have a dramatically, you know, it's cut in half, the risk of having myocardial infarction. Now, these are the abstainers. Now, what about if these healthy, strong people also drink some alcohol, what happens to the risk of myocardial infarction? It drops dramatically, about a 60% further reduction. And regardless of how much of a couch potato or a lean, healthy person you are, the drinkers tend to have a further decrease in their risk. But, you know, my opponents say, look, we want to see experiments, okay? There have been lots of experiments, thousands of experiments, looking at the effects of alcohol and polyphenols on cardiovascular disease in animals and in humans, and very consistently, our animals that are given alcohol increase their HDL cholesterol, the good cholesterol that protects us, but perhaps more important, they have protective effects on coagulation and increased fibrinolysis. So if you do form a clot in your coronary and it gets lysed very quickly, dissolved very quickly, you don't get the myocardial infarction. There are direct effects on arterial endothelium, ventricular function, and inflammation and glucose metabolism that are very well shown from these experiments. Just an example, here's one very old one. This is the percent of the coronaries on a high cholesterol, high fat diet. If you're given water, it's 100% coronaries. In comparison with that, you'll see if you have some whiskey, a white wine, red wine, there's a decrease in your risk of coronary artery lesions. This happens to be not in drinkers or wine drinkers or beer drinkers, but rabbits. But if we turn to humans, there's a very good study in the British Medical Journal a couple of years ago of human trials. And there have been 63 for clinical trials reported in the literature, and they look at lipid biomarkers, and consistently they show that the HDL is higher when they give people alcohol. These are all human trials, and they tend to have a low density lipoprotein as well. Inflammatory markers are decreased. Hemostatic factors are improved, as I'll mention. Endothelial function is improved. And your adiponectin is consistently shown to be increased, which decreases your risk of diabetes. And we even now have the genetic patterns. This is the molecular mechanisms. You see that there is catechin and quercetin, which are two of the polyphenols in wine, and alcohol, and all three of these tend to enter this molecular pathway that affects the TPA gene. So that there are separate sites for catechin, for alcohol, and for quercetin. And if you're drinking wine rather than beer, as some of people do, you get all of these protections because the catechin and the quercetin and the alcohol stimulate decrease the DPA, increase the TPA, decrease PAI1, and lead to increased fibrinolysis. Now, focused on coronary disease, I just want to mention that these same lifestyle factors, BMI less than 25, physically active, non-smoker, high adherence, if you have all of these things in Houston's study from the Netherlands, and they said, well, your risk then of having diabetes is one, but what happens if you're a real couch potato and have none of these? You see there's a dramatic increase from one to almost four. Marked increase in these other lifestyle factors, even among abstainers. Now, among these abstainers, those who also consume half a drink up to one drink per woman, two drinks for men, you'll see there's a further reduction. If you're an abstainer, your risk is one, it drops in half, essentially. If you have moderate healthy factors, or if you have no healthy factors, in each case, being a drinker adds an additional large amount to your risk of diabetes. But you're going to hear alcohol is a carcinogen. I hate to tell you, Rich, but I had bacon this morning. Despite the trosamines, I've been grilling steaks outside this summer, and I know about these polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons that are all carcinogens. It's not that it's a carcinogen, but what is the effect? What's the magnitude of the effect? And according to the EPIC study, which is a very good study in Europe of nutritional factors relating to cancer, heavy alcohol consumption marked increases upper aerodigestive cancer. We've known this for a long time, and there's no question that if you're an alcoholic, your risk goes up dramatically for mouth cancer, tongue cancer, throat, esophagus, and so forth. However, even in the EPIC study, moderate consumption accounts for a very small amount of cancers in women and in men. And even in the US, we have the same type of thing. This is the National Health Interview, more than 300,000 subjects with 8,000 cancer deaths. And if you're a lifetime abstainer in this study, your risk of cancer was assigned one, the relative risk. And if you're a heavy drinker, it goes up. You know that. But what happens if you're a light drinker or a moderate drinker? Moderate is from a half a drink up to one drink a day for women. No increase. And actually, for light drinkers, there's a slight increase. So I think it's quite clear, this term, as far as cancer is concerned, heavier than light moderate drinking is the factor that relates to the increase in cancer. But you all know that, how do we know how much people drink in our studies? We have to ask them. We don't have a magic instrument that we can put in the esophagus and calculate how much alcohol goes down the gullet. So I think it's we realize that we have to, there's underreporting. But who's underreporting? And now we are able to identify subjects who are likely to be underreported. This was first described by Klatsky in the huge Kaiser Permanente study in California, more than a million people. They have huge records. And they found that in one study, they said, who reports moderate drinking, 1 to 2 drinks a day? And they found that 18% elsewhere in the medical records had an alcohol-related disorder, alcoholism, liver cirrhosis or something, which indicated that they really were an alcoholic, even though at the time they were asked, they said, oh, I have 1 or 2 drinks per day. But then they found that there are 47% of the people, these moderate drinkers, who had no alcohol, or they had extensive records, but no evidence of an alcohol-related disorder. And they said, well, these people are unlikely to be underreporters. And when they related this to cancer, they had more than 14,000 cancer cases among these subjects, of about 100,000. And for the moderate drinkers who did not have it, any evidence of an alcohol-related disorder, these are the probably likely to be underreporting their alcohol. The total risk of cancer versus abstainers, 0.98. Essentially exactly the same as the non-drinkers. For the moderate drinkers who had other evidence of alcohol disorder, likely underreporting, their risk of cancer was 33% increase. So I think we've got more and more data suggesting that the problem with these alcohol studies, we found the same thing in Framingham. If anyone ever reports that he or she has had alcohol abuse, we know to classify them separately from people who otherwise say, well, I'm a moderate drinker. What is the effect on total mortality? And guess what? We have a J-shaped curve. Since light amounts of alcohol don't increase the cancer and drop down the leading cause of death, coronary heart disease and stroke, you see it goes down if you drink a little. Here's one drink at about 12 grams and goes up if you get to higher levels. But I like this, the idea that is shown by this study from the Netherlands, where they took 50-year-olds who were healthy and they said, let's look at survival. So these people started it at 50, they were healthy at the time, and then they followed them for mortality, total mortality, and you'll notice that the solid line are wine drinkers. And guess what? Everybody who drinks wine will die. You can quote me on that. Everybody who drinks wine will die. But if you look at half of them were dead, but when did they die? They died at about 82. If you look at the no alcohol users, they died sooner. Half of them were dead by 75. So that, however you look at it, moderate drinking is associated with a healthier lifestyle. I think it's important that we give a balanced and scientifically sound message to the public. And unfortunately, we get a lot of what I think are biased things. The World Health Organization has been noted for this. This is the program manager at the alcohol unit in WHO Europe, recently wrote earlier this year, every drink, whatever the type of alcohol, adds to your risk of dying early. The protective effect of drinking alcohol is a myth. No data support this. And even a BU scientist, according to Bostonian magazine, argues that deaths from alcohol dwarf any small number of people who may derive benefit from low-dose alcohol. I don't think he or she has seen the curves. Among all people who start drinking, 5 to 10 times as many die from it as a benefit. I don't know of any data that support that. There's a very good paper by Phil Cole, used to be at Harvard in Alabama, talking about what are the moral bases, 2 minutes ago, I said, policy that we set should be based not on paternalism, we professionals know what is best for all you people out there, but on education and the assumption that informed people make healthful choices. And Cole adds that health education should be education, not propaganda. It becomes the latter when only one side of an issue is presented to the public. So if you read, Ellison says, a drink of wine a day will make you live 20 years longer, that's propaganda. If you hear from someone else that a single drink of alcohol puts you on the slippery slope to alcoholism, that's propaganda. We have to give a balanced message. And I think, to me, the common sense living in with this, well, first of all, we've known the common sense for a long time. Abraham Lincoln, it has long been recognized that the problems with alcohol relate not to the use of a bad thing, but to the abuse of a good thing. And this was 172 years ago. Let me end with what I call common sense, with an anecdote you've heard, some of you have heard, that Jack Rabbit Johansson was a cross-country skier and was still out on the slopes at 101 years of age. And the reporter said, Mr. Johansson, tell us to what you attribute your long and healthy life. He said, well, you don't smoke, you had lots of exercise, and don't drink too much. And the reporter said, thank you. And then Jack Rabbit reached over and said, on the other hand, don't drink too little either.
Should alcohol consumption be encouraged as part of the healthy lifestyle? No, absolutely not. And here's why. So I have no commercial financial interests to report that supported this work. I have never received, unlike my opponent, funds directly or indirectly. No, it's not really, it's actually not funny. Restricted or unrestricted from the makers of alcoholic beverages, and also not a cute statement, I do drink alcohol. So I'm not against drinking alcohol for myself as a personal decision. This is a letter that appeared in the Globe Saturday that I wrote in response to what I think was Jeff Jacoby's irresponsible and not really well thought out argument. He asked, why can't alcohol labels tout benefits? And I think the answer is because the alcohol industry, which by the way has very good scientists on their payroll, are well aware of how limited the evidence is. If they could put that on the label, they would. But they didn't. And then in my letter, I outlined this talk. So you can look at it there, but I won't go through it here, and I'll just outline it here. The arguments are there benefits? We don't know, and likely not, and you'll see why. Are there harms of low doses of alcohol? I'm not going to waste my time on are there harms of high doses of alcohol, but are there harms of low dose of this pharmacological substance, which is what we're talking about? Yes. And are there harms of encouraging alcohol use? This is a less well-studied area, but I think it will become clear to you after Tim and I talk that there are harms, both for individuals and populations. Now, as Kurt pointed out, there are zero randomized controlled trials, zero, with any morbidity or mortality outcome of low-dose alcohol or ethanol. There are observational studies, however, that ask the wrong questions. and are very subject to selection bias, are hopelessly confounded, have poor exposure assessment, and we're going to use this information to decide exactly what dose of a pharmacological substance we're going to give. That doesn't make any sense to me. They yield non-specific effects on outcomes, and they're not biologically plausible. The mechanisms that you've just heard about, some, have been discredited. There are effects at very low, implausible doses, and there is, if there is any benefit, it's at a narrow toxic to therapeutic index. That is, a very fine line between where you go from this tremendous benefit to harm. Now, here's an example of a question. All you survey researchers, put on your survey methodology hats and evaluate this question for me. This is one of the more, you know, common type of question. How many cups, glasses, or drinks of these beverages, and they show wine, beer, and spirits, do you usually drink a day, and for how many years? And they ask that usually once. First of all, double-barreled question, right? They ask that question once, and then they look and see what happens 20 years later. Now, this is not a way to evaluate a daily dose of a pharmacological substance. That, we would never allow that for any other pharmacological substance that we wanted to use as a preventive intervention. In this, which is one of the better studies by Michael Fun, published in the New England Journal in 1997, about 50% of people were excluded due to missing alcohol data. That's a little bit of a problem, and this is not uncommon in these studies. Basic methodological problems, despite being published in the New England Journal. Now, the other thing is that usually you see how many drinks per day. Well, most of these studies use terrible assessments that are not well validated of drinking, as I've just demonstrated. And then they take the number of drinks someone reports, and they divide it by the number of days, and they say X drinks per day. But that's not the way people drink. In the United States, people who drink, drink 1 to 2 times per week. So the reporting is of how many drinks a day you ought to have to get whatever outcome it is in the study. That's not actually what they were drinking. Now let's look at this table in a little bit of detail. These are tests for trend. So starting with less than daily drinking, going to 1 a day to 2 to 3 a day, we see a trend starting from 0 and going up for cirrhosis. And then for alcohol-related cancers, the same thing. It becomes, well, borderline statistical significance even with less than daily use. And then for incident heart disease, we see this benefit and a trend there. And then, but also alcohol appears to be good at decreasing all other causes of mortality. I wonder what the mechanism is for that. In women, however, let's look at women. In women, yeah, we still see the cirrhosis. We see breast cancer trend starting at less than daily through to increased frequency. We don't see any significant benefit on heart disease. And then, again, a benefit for all other diseases, all other causes of mortality. It's a really quite interesting substance. Now, there's no effect, I have to summarize lots of studies due to time, but there's no effect for age 30 to 59 and for low cardiovascular disease risk people. And if you study young men who are starting to drink, then you find an increase in mortality, a 37% increase in mortality over 25 years. This was a cohort published in the BMJ in 1999. And here's an interesting one, which was in women in the US. This is Nurses' Health Study, also from Harvard. And at Harvard, they found that if you have those lifestyle factors, remember Kurt talked about those 5 lifestyle factors, if you have 4 of them and then you add alcohol, alcohol makes absolutely no difference. So as long as you have those other ones, you're good. Now here's the narrow therapeutic index and some inconsistency. The mortality nadir in these observational studies is at less than 1 drink per day, and it increases above that. That's the J-shaped curve you see on the right. Kurt showed this slide as well, Di Castelnuovo. Any benefit is lost with 1 heavy drinking episode. Half of US drinkers have reported 1 heavy drinking episode, so they wouldn't get any benefit at all. And the other interesting thing is that the size of this purported benefit and the cutoffs, like exactly how you should dose this, vary by country. So it's a pharmacological substance with biological activity that we're depending on for some benefit, and yet it works differently in the US and Europe and Australia, Japan, China. It depends on where the study was done and what the population was. That doesn't make too much sense to me. And then lastly on this slide, if you look at the curves on the right-hand side, the curve on the bottom is, these are studies in which, this is a meta-analysis, systematic review, total mortality related to drinking. And the curve that's way on the bottom here, which shows a dramatic benefit, is not well adjusted for confounding. These other curves, you see a substantial decrement in the benefit when you begin to adjust for things. This suggests that there's lots of uncontrolled confounding in these studies, and what we see here is their best effort to adjust for confounding. But we all know how hard that is, and you have to know which factors to adjust for, and most studies don't have detailed information on all the correct confounders. Now, light drinking, without a dose response, this was an interesting review by Fekjar in Addiction in 2013, light drinking with no dose response is correlated with a reduced risk of all of these things listed on the slide. And let me point out some of the ones that I cannot figure out how that would be possible. Asthma, the common cold, hearing loss, low birth weight and prematurity, lower urinary tract symptoms, poor child development, that is, you know, kid being smarter, all cancer mortality. So these are things that just, why would this be? This is good for everything, it appears. And one of my favorite studies done by Tanya Chikritz in Australia, she found better health status in, now get this, the partners of and adult family members and children of light drinkers. So if you drink light amounts, your kids will be healthier. That is just bizarre. Don't know. Implausible. This is implausible. Confounding. My colleague Tim Namey, of 30 cardiovascular disease-associated risk factors, 90% were more prevalent among non-drinkers. You can begin to see the difficulty with adjusting for confounding. You've got to put 27 factors into the equation at least. And this, of course, makes those who drink appear healthier in these studies. And you can't see this list. You're not supposed to see it. You're just supposed to see how many there are. But I'm going to point out, as I did on the last slide, a couple that are interesting. So low-dose alcohol is associated with fewer teeth removed, flu shots, it apparently also causes you, you gotta get straight this causality versus association. It causes you to get colon cancer and cholesterol screening. And it also causes you to previously have been successful at graduating high school. This is implausible stuff. Confounding and selection bias more. More frequent drinking is associated with health benefits associated, probably because less frequent drinkers are more likely to drink heavily and to have a higher prevalence of 13 of 15 cardiovascular disease risk factors, as from this article I'm cited at the bottom of the page. Again, drinking appears healthy because other unhealthy traits occur in non-drinkers. The beneficial effects are smaller or non-existent in studies that adjust better for confounding and in studies that handle sick quitters better. That is, that they exclude people who've quit because they run into trouble with their drinking. And these are two that I've cited on the slide. Implausible. More confounding. Effects of beverage type are inconsistent. They all contain alcohol, but the effects seem different for different types of alcohol. For example, the effects of wine seem stronger in terms of benefits, but not beer or liquor, or better than beer or liquor, on vascular disease and on mortality. Now, it also turns out that wine drinkers are better educated, have better diets, tend to exercise more. That's at least in Western countries. But could we test this maybe by looking at another culture? Because maybe what's going on here is culture, not alcohol. And if you look in other populations, so if you look in African Americans, there's no heart disease or all-cause mortality benefit in African Americans. How could that be? I don't know. And if you look in India, there's no benefit, even starting at low levels. All you see is increase in risk starting with any drinking. Now there, the context is different, right? Religious Hindus are not expected to drink, so the context of what's going on in terms of drinking and other associated factors is going to be different. Where's the J? It's gone. Selection bias. Established low-dose drinkers, that's those of you in the audience who continue to drink low doses of alcohol and have not stopped because you've run into trouble and you like it. I'm talking about you. You are a select group. You've chosen to drink. You have not died. You didn't quit. You didn't become a heavy drinker. And you might be willing and able to participate in a study. Those people are different from if I were to start and have you either drink alcohol or not drink alcohol. Members of the general population who might begin to drink or drink more on the basis of an encouraging public health recommendation, such as we're debating today, are different from those of you who I just described. So encouraging drinking, to drink or not to drink, that is the question. Now, for those of you who are familiar with football, it's a game that's played in the fall in the United States. Coach Darrell Royal in 1962 said, when you put the ball in the air, three things can happen to you. and two of them are bad. And for those of you who are not familiar with football, you could drop the ball, or it could get intercepted. And the third one is you carry the ball and you score points for your team. So the idea here is if we're going to have a public health recommendation, it's going to be about drinking. And lots of things can happen when you drink. You could use a different dose than the one that we may be able to try to specify, even though there's no good data to try to specify it. You start to drink, and then one thing that could happen to you is that you die. And of course, the young are disproportionately affected by alcohol. It's a disproportionate cause of mortality in the young. The black line here is where studies begin. These are cohort studies that we're talking about, all the kinds of evidence we've been talking about today. You could either become a heavy drinker, you could become a low-dose drinker, and by the way, I don't use the word moderate because that's value-laden, right? It suggests that it's good when the data don't suggest that. We're talking about low dose of this pharmacological substance, or you could quit. The problem is that people who have quit in these studies are misclassified often as non-drinkers, because you don't know that they quit, or they're excluded. If we say, oh yeah, they stopped drinking because they were sick, we're going to exclude them from our study. And then you've removed the, you know, what you would do in a randomized trial is you would do intention to treat, right? And but now you're selecting and you're not counting the outcomes from this group. This will always make the low-dose drinkers look better. It's a serious, serious threat to validity. By the way, I'm not against, Martha, I'm not against observational studies. But observational studies, like Miguel Hernan said earlier this year, they have to ask the right question, and they can't have serious threats to validity. And in this case, there are very serious threats to validity. This debate is not, by the way, about whether to tell low-dose drinkers to stop. I'm not going to come and take away your guns. I mean, your alcohol. But this is about whether we're encouraging them or not. Now, biological plausibility that Kurt told us about. He said, and he put it on a big slide and he showed you 13 factors, but he didn't point out that only 4 of the 13 factors that were associated with cardiovascular disease as potential mechanisms were affected by 1 to 2 drinks a day experimentally. And that was HDL, adiponectin, apolipoprotein A1, and decreased fibrinogen. First of all, we don't know that the amount that those things changed had any clinical relevance. And remember that the epidemiological studies that have been cited in favor of benefit are actually lower doses than these. And in terms of biological plausibility, if you have a drink in a day, it's gone by the next day. So how is it affecting all those parameters hours and days later? How does that work? Is that even plausible? There were no effects on 9 of the 13 factors that Kurt listed on his slide, and I listed them there. That's the Brian paper from the BMJ. Now, HDL has been purported to be a large reason for why alcohol is beneficial. Low HDL is, in fact, associated with cardiovascular disease, but things that raise HDL, it turns out we're learning, do not reduce the risk for myocardial infarction. Association versus causation, once again. Biological plausibility still lacking. Carotid intima media thickness is a marker for atherosclerosis. It increases with drinking. There's no J-shaped curve. Coronary artery calcification, a marker of coronary artery disease and heart disease. Calcification increases with drinking. No J-shaped curve. These start at 1 to 2 drinks a day. Where's the J? It's gone. No mechanism. Studies also find harms of low-dose alcohol. We generally don't recommend, even nitrosamines and bacon, we don't recommend preventive interventions that are thought to be harmful. We come up with other things. So yes, alcohol is a carcinogen, according to the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services National Toxicology Program, the WHO, which, you know, turns out they're concerned about health. I don't see a problem with the WHO making health recommendations. The World Cancer Research Fund and the American Institute for Cancer Research. There are plausible mechanisms that I don't have time to make the case for, but they're listed on the slide there, and you can review those later if you like. And what about cancers? Alcohol associated with cancers then, and let's point out one, which is the big one for women. 3 to 6 drinks per week on average associated with a 15% increase in the relative risk. 15 cancers per 1,000 women for each additional drink per day, and you can see the distribution there, 11 are breast, 1 liver, 1 colon. So not just the aerodigestive cancers. Kurt talks about the aerodigestive cancers. Those are the ones heavy drinkers. I'm talking about low-dose drinking, not heavy drinking here. Low-dose alcohol, a leading cause of preventable cause of cancer death. So we just talked about the various types of cancers. Here are the thresholds, 1 drink a day, 1 drink a day, And I'll just get to this red one here, which is less than 1.5 drinks per day accounts for a third of these cancer deaths up here. And 15%, again, not heavy drinking, low dose alcohol accounts for about 15% of breast cancer deaths. There is no threshold for risk reuse. There usually isn't for carcinogens. We know how carcinogens work. There's not usually a threshold, and we don't say, oh, why don't you just have a little bit? Here's some other risks of low-dose alcohol. Low-dose alcohol. Hypertension, cirrhosis, drink driving, interpersonal problems, hemorrhagic stroke, violent death, hip fracture, fetal harm, brain atrophy, a linear association, no J-shaped curve, medication interactions, alcohol disorders, infertility, overweight, which is limited to beer and spirits, which tells you something's not the alcohol, might have something to do with the type of context, and impairment. These are all at low doses. You can see the thresholds there. Now it has been all but confirmed, said Morley Safer in 1991, solving the French paradox, which is they eat lots of cream and cheese and they don't die from heart disease. Why? Morley Safer says the answer to the riddle, the explanation of the paradox, may lie in this inviting glass. And I think a quite dapper looking Kurt Ellison said the right thing here. He said the right thing in his interview, and this was a very famous interview. Probably many of you have heard of this already. He said, there's something about the French that seems to be protecting them, and we're not sure what it is. We're looking for it. The resulting demand for red wine, the New York Times wrote a few years later, was seen as the potentially biggest boon to the wine industry since the repeal of Prohibition. So this was big impact on big dollars. Well, I think the paradox has been solved by a randomized controlled trial, and it's been solved without alcohol. The Mediterranean diet with olive oil or nuts, as many of you know from this study, reduced cardiovascular disease compared with the low-fat diet published in the New England Journal of Medicine last year. Alcohol consumption was similar at baseline and at follow-up in all three groups. No evidence here. Now, that's not what they were testing. They weren't testing alcohol, but it seems that diet may be the explanation. Now, should we encourage alcohol for health? Well, the standard for recommending chemo prevention, which this is safety and efficacy placebo-controlled trials of specific doses. This is possible. I served on the Data Safety Monitoring Board for a study that was piloting this. Over at Harvard, they're doing a study of chocolate, a randomized trial of chocolate consumption. This can be done with long-term outcomes. A pharmaceutical intervention that's a carcinogen. We generally don't recommend these to test for prevention in any dose. And while well-done observational studies can be valuable, the threats to validity in this case, selection and confounding in particular, are serious. And you all know many other cases of observational studies, like with hormone replacement therapy, the wrong question was asked. That's what Miguel Hernan pointed out in his talk a few months ago. And there were 30 or 40 studies showing 40% decreases in heart disease. They were consistent. Remember Kurt showed the slide about, and he said, look how consistent all these results are. These big reductions in cardiovascular disease, yeah, they were consistently wrong. That's what we've learned about hormone replacement. We've learned about statins for COPD, statins for sepsis, beta carotene, vitamin E. The list goes on. We can't be fooled. Effects of starting to drink in middle age, what would they be? Who would be eligible to start drinking, by the way? Who doesn't drink? 80%, 60 to 80% of the US population drinks. Those who don't drink are often pregnant. They don't drink for religious reasons. Taste, which is actually an important issue because we don't know if people don't like it. Would it work well for them to give them these benefits? Children don't drink. People with family or past alcohol disorders, medical conditions, and on medications that interact with alcohol. So how does that, you know, who are we gonna get to start drinking? And alcohol use disorders are vastly under-recognized. What dose and frequency would we exactly recommend based on those observational studies? How would those recommendations be followed? Will they stick to those doses or will they increase them? And what would the population effects be? And lastly, corporate social responsibility. There's a big industry out there. This is the Drink Aware campaign from the Great Britain that shows a lovely young lady on their campaign to educate the public about alcohol. They're not talking about decreasing drinking. Nothing that they do is effective at decreasing heavy drinking. It's all about getting people to drink. And these are the folks that, as Kurt mentioned, fund the reviews that he produces and seminars for researchers to present their work. This industry is thrilled with these observational data, and they determine that what we're gonna talk about is moderate drinking and, quote, responsible drinking. It doesn't seem like it's presenting both sides. Here's what the industry's doing. How do you like that ad? Do you think that's responsible? Doesn't feel very responsible to me. So this is a debate about health, not about morals, personal freedoms, pleasure, enjoyment, laws. There may be other reasons to drink. There are many reasons why we do lots of different things. Are there benefits? Probably not. Are there harms? Yes. Are there harms of encouraging alcohol use? Yes. Should it be encouraged? No.
In preparing for this, I looked at a study by James and Paula Dietz, The Times of Their Lives, published by Freeman in the year 2000, which was a study of Plymouth, the first Plymouth colony, down the street. They were drinkers. They had taverns, which they called, believe it or not, to reduce the excitement level in this room, taverns they called ordinaries. And you know what? We're still here. Somehow it worked. That if you look at the epidemiology of this and the detail that we've just had, which I surely appreciate and admire and don't totally feel comfortable in answering, not because I think that I'm wrong, but I know that I'm not professionally capable in this area. At the same time, if I look at human groups and I say, what keeps the group going? I have to be cognizant of the fact that it's not easy to be a social human being. And it's evident that a lot of the reason that people drink is because it makes their social lives, if not simply easier, at least more illuminating and satisfying. I did my doctoral research in Ghana in West Africa, and one of the things I found at first confounding and then I understood fully was that when not all that often, but when I got invited to a party by the local characters, one of the first things they did was take a half a bottle of gin and pour it into the ground. Well, to an impecunious student, this seemed like a kind of willfulness that was beyond calculation. So I said, why the hell are you doing that? And they said, it's for the ancestors. We want them at the party. And they meant it. And they did it. And they had those ancestors at the party. Now, this is a completely stupid behavior by any form of analysis according to a statistical interpretation. But I tell you something, they had great parties. And when you go into a room at a medical meeting and there are 275 potential enemies leering at you as you walk in, one of the first things you're likely to do, if you're normal, is get a drink. And the famous ad, one of the quintessential ads in this pernicious industry that's killing us all, the alcohol industry, is the Budweiser commercial where a guy is a lumberjack and it's his first day of work and he's got a nice new flannel shirt and his boots are still stiff and he doesn't quite know where to put his axe and whatever. But then he works all day and he comes into the bar of the little town afterwards and some guy whom he doesn't know looks at him and hands him a beer and said, this Bud's for you. He's made it. He's in. It's not unimportant to be in. And so when we look at these issues of alcohol, we have to ask, why the ordinary down the street? Why did it work? Why aren't they all dead? Well, because it's hard to live, particularly if you're living in a new environment and you're trying to construct something. What you have to do is interact. And there's no question that alcohol has an impact on interaction, sometimes moderate and benign, sometimes dreadful and horrifying. But alcohol as a drug has been very widely and extensively and endlessly tested. And you don't need to compare societies in terms of their alcohol consumption, but let me suggest, I personally, religious reasons aside, I really would not like to live in Saudi Arabia because I don't like somebody telling me I can't have beer for reasons which are, in my view, ridiculous. And yet, I would really prefer to be in Italy where Sure, you have some grappa after dinner, you've had some wine. That is, alcohol has to be seen as a socially normative phenomenon. We're a mammal. We share. We share food. We share liquids. And if we don't share, we're not happy. And alcohol appears to be one of the facilitating mechanisms. Again, I'm not advocating that everybody drink. I'm merely looking back and saying, why did they survive down there at Plymouth? What did they do? It wasn't great. There was no television. They had no iPhones. How did they manage? Well, the ordinary might have been one of the ordinary ways that they did this. I've been very concerned, again, as a kind of somewhat informed outsider to this area, and I don't know the statistics well enough, but I'm very concerned about a class of population I call concernocrats. Concernocrats are people who are deeply concerned about other people, and their power is to do good for them. And they are very eager and very skillful and usually funded by organizations equally concernocratic. Personally, I try to keep out of the room when they're operating because somehow they can get it wrong. You talked about the French paradox in the picture of Kurt looking elegant. I don't know why you were surprised. He's an elegant-looking guy. But in any case, there's another French paradox. I'm not going to ask, because it's embarrassing. I'm not going to ask if everyone here drink or not drink. I asked when I was in France about 8 years ago. I was very interested in, still am, in the use of drugs to coerce behavior. And I was particularly interested in Ritalin. I have some background because I had done a study in monkeys of the impact of birth control medication on monkey sexual behavior, and it was drastic because, of course, the females on the Depo-Provera were all pregnant, which was a confounding factor to the male because somehow it just wasn't right. And it equally perturbed the females, but when the drug washed out of the system, they went back to their normal embraces. But I, from that interest, and because having done that study, I was asked by Hoffman LaRoche if I would do a study for them of the social benefits of Valium and Librium. I said, let's have lunch. And 3 years later, Valium and Librium were off the market, and they're very hard to get. So I've been very suspicious of concernocrats wielding drugs, or even arguments about drugs. Let me give you one example about the French paradox. I was in France and I was at a lunch and there was a professor of medicine from the University of Paris sitting next to me, and I, taking advantage of every opportunity for data gathering, I said, Dr. So-and-so, tell me about Ritalin use in France. Innocent American question. Many of you have been dealing with that. He said, well, this year, in that particular year or the year before, in all of France, there were 4,600 prescriptions for Ritalin. 4,600. That's a high school, a large high school in Brookline, easily produce that statistic. And so one asks, what is it about the French that allows them to not take Ritalin, which I happen personally to think of as a dangerous drug because it's given invariably to young kids. We don't know the developmental effects, and it would be hardly surprising to see some of them end up shooting up the school when they're 19. We don't know, we just don't know, but the concernocrat feels a license to drive, if you will. So again, I'm not sure this is the proper subject for debate in the sense that it's not an either or question because, is that for me? Okay. It's not an either or question, it's a how much question. because, as we heard, 60 to 80% of people drink. A lot of people require a certain amount of alcohol to deal with the perturbations and tribulations and uncertainties of human life. And this is something that we can evaluate as either a good thing or a bad thing. Do you want to go into a party of fellow professionals leering at you, knowing that your last paper was such an abject failure and eager to come up and tell you, but somehow, because you've had a drink or two, you couldn't care less? These are real human situations. And yes, the epidemiological studies are fine. Both Kurtz and Richards, fine. And I admire them, and I think they're important. At the same time, one has to look, given my trade, looking at how people actually live, what they do, what they think about it, how they get on through the day, I'm not prepared to say that if everybody, 60 to 80% of the population, take a substance which they have easily figured out how to make in an astonishing variety of interesting manners, by the way, that somehow one should be scornful of that, or not even embrace it as a way of recognizing that for most people, most of the time, living is not easy. There are always issues to be faced. And sometimes it seems people use this particular drug in a manner which makes them feel, it's a self-delusion no doubt, that things are a little easier. I would far prefer to, well, I don't want to get into the obesity issue because it's a totally separate matter, but the fact is that when we look at our own evolutionary history, we have to, and this is the pattern of a democratic system, we have to assume that there's a normal curve of response. I always tell students that the shortest analytical distance between two points is a normal curve. You're going to get one, you're going to get the other. Got to start with that because that's how evolution worked. That was Charles Darwin's insight. And so you can't have one without the other, as it were. So it, again, I'm not sure I like these kinds of debates because I don't know if they end up being fruitful. And anyway, it's too early to have a drink for those people who solve intellectual ambiguity with booze. Thank you very much, all the same.
Dear fellow concernocrats, my name is Tim Nagy, and I'm here to help set my august opponents straight. And I'm going to talk a little bit today about emerging evidence, a very important body of emerging evidence that sheds light on this issue, and provide a bit of a summary and wrap-up to what Rich and I have been discussing. But first, my disclosures, I'm funded by BU, Codman Square, and the dreaded NIH and CDC, although they've never told me not to say anything, and I've not received funds or support direct or otherwise from producers or sellers of alcohol, and since these guys have been disclosing their personal history, I'm going to have to trump them and say that I come from a long line of English brewers on my mother's side, Reading, England. So there you go. So the emerging evidence that I'm going to discuss today is Mendelian randomization studies. And in comparison to Lionel's engaging talk, I hope this doesn't put you to sleep, but I think it's important, and for those of you who are familiar, you can chime in. So Mendelian randomization studies compares people with and without genetic variants, we'll call them genotypes, and they study variants that affect alcohol consumption to assess the effect of alcohol consumption on outcomes. They take advantage of the fact that the allocation of genes is random, which very well should, in theory, address confounding. They follow Mendel's second law, which is related to Darwin, and I know our august opponent was the Darwin professor at Rutgers. They also take advantage of the fact that genotypes are not caused by disease, so that eliminates reverse causation. And finally, they take advantage of the fact that genotypes are randomized at birth, which importantly enables the assessment of lifetime effects of particular exposures, in this case, alcohol consumption. So it's more analogous to an intention to treat study design. You cannot quit your genotype, and thus reduces that particular form of selection bias. So So Mendelian randomization studies, there are differences, but they share a number of similarities to RCTs. What you need is to find a candidate allele that is related to or causal for a reduced or increased exposure that you want to study. Then there can be confounding, but that should be, in theory, be equalized, and you can examine for that. And then you look at outcomes, not based on whether or not somebody had the exposure in question, but whether they had the genotype in question or not. Now, over the past 5 to 7 years, there's been quite a large body of research for Mendelian randomization studies that are related to our discussion today about the effects of low-dose alcohol. Contrary to observational studies, Mendelian randomization studies suggest that there is, in fact, no J-shaped curve for the relationship between alcohol consumption and either average blood pressure or hypertension. Again, the J-shaped curve means that it implies that there's some benefit at low doses. There is no J-shaped curve for the relationship between alcohol and body mass index. There is no protection against dementia, even for low-dose alcohol consumption. There's no protection against diabetes. And it provides a third line of evidence that HDL, while it is associated with coronary heart disease, is in fact not causal for coronary heart disease. I want to talk about one variant genotype and how it relates to alcohol consumption. Compared with the usual genotype of the alcohol dehydrogenase gene, the RS122-9984 variant of the 1B gene, which I will happily refer to for the remainder of this talk as the variant genotype, causes reduced metabolism of alcohol, which can result in an unpleasant sensation for people who are heterozygotes or even a flushing reaction for homozygotes. Having this, in number of studies, having the variant genotype is associated with less alcohol consumption and an increased likelihood of being an abstainer. Based on observational studies, we would expect that the presence of the variant genotype would be associated with an increased overall burden of CVD, cardiovascular disease, and related risk factors, particularly among those groups of people who consume low doses of alcohol. Now, today I'm going to tell you about a new Mendelian randomization study that came out just 2 months ago in the British Medical Journal. And it studied the effect of, or the relationship rather, between alcohol and CHD events using this variant genotype that I introduced you to on the previous slide. It's a very important study because all of the possible mortality benefits from low-dose alcohol consumption are based on the idea that it must be protective for cardiovascular disease. This study was of 260,000 people of European ancestry predominantly, pooled from 56 studies. And this ADHB variant genotype, that as we remember is associated with reduced drinking among all groups of drinkers, so reduced drinking overall and within categories, was associated with a reduced, not an increased, risk of CHD events in the form of fatal and non-fatal events. Furthermore, these findings were consistent across consumption categories, including among those drinking low doses of alcohol, which for this study they classified as 0 to 21 British units a week, or about somewhere less than 2 drinks per day in US standard drinks. So this variant genotype was also protective for ischemic stroke, though had no association with stroke overall, nor diabetes. So the findings suggest that across all the pooled study populations, that overall the consumption of alcohol was associated with a net increase in CHD events, and that for people it implies that the less one drinks, the better it is for CVD health, regardless of how much one drinks. Now, there's an important type of limitation to these studies. That is that this genotype variant might be associated by random chance or other reasons with important confounders, or that it could have a direct protective effect on cardiovascular disease, or might have a genetic linkage with other genes or genotypes that are protective for CHD. And if that was the case, then we would expect then that having this gene among non-drinkers would also confer CHD benefit. But in fact, these guys, to their credit, looked at the effect of this genotype and found that among non-drinkers with this variant genotype, the relative risk of coronary heart disease was unaffected. So this is powerful evidence that the effect of the variant genotype is mediated through alcohol. and the authors, one of which included the very eminent Dr. Ellison, who sits before me now, they concluded that this suggests that reduction of alcohol consumption, even for light to moderate drinkers, is beneficial for cardiovascular health, and that our results therefore challenge the concept of a cardioprotective effect associated with light to moderate alcohol consumption in observational studies, and suggest that this result may have been due to residual confounding or selection bias. Very nicely said. So in summary, there's a statement in medicine, primum non nocere, first do no harm. Or in the immortal words of the Branxton Lions Club, we have two cemeteries and no hospital. Drive carefully. We can't pretend that everyone would drink moderately were alcohol promoted as part of a healthy lifestyle. Nobody who initiates drinking intends to have a bad outcome from drinking, or to drink immoderately, whatever that might mean, in the long run. There's also something very important to alcohol epidemiologists called the single distribution model of alcohol consumption, and that is that across developed countries, over a long period of time, there is a very, very tight correlation between the proportion of the population that drinks alcohol and the number of people who drink heavily or in risky ways. In the United States, 80% of alcohol is consumed by those drinking in excess of national guidelines, and almost half of drinkers exceed U.S. dietary guidelines suggested daily limits for low-dose or for low-risk alcohol consumption. And finally, very few Americans, let alone alcohol researchers, have any agreement or understanding of what moderate actually means. But we do know that, as our picture here illustrates, Americans tend to overestimate what that might mean. So the overview here is that we have no randomized trials of the effect of low-dose alcohol. We have no study of the public health effects of promoting even moderate alcohol consumption. Observational studies of low-dose alcohol are biased in favor of moderate drinkers, played by selection bias. Remember, they ignore all those less healthy groups, and confounding. It's the reflection of its well-being and not its genesis. Many arguments about biologic plausibility are no longer so plausible. Genetic randomization studies suggest that alcohol only causes increases in CVD risk factors and events, even among those with low-dose consumption. And finally, there are many proven and safe alternatives to reduce CVD mortality that are available and currently underutilized. So we really want to encourage alcohol for health. Even if we assume CVD benefit from low-dose drinking, alcohol causes more deaths and life loss than it prevents. Worldwide, alcohol causes about 10 deaths for every one life averted. And you say, well, that's all it is. In the developed world, it's similar to what it is in the US. So for example, in the US, alcohol causes about 106,000 deaths each year and averts 26,000. So about a 4-to-1 kill ratio. And it causes about 2.8 million years of potential life lost compared to a savings of 330,000 years of potential life lost. And furthermore, the evidence of harms from excessive consumption is stronger than that for benefits of low-dose consumption. That has to do with many of the conditions of harms either have short latency periods or high effect sizes or high alcohol attributable fraction compared to low-dose studies, which are bedeviled by the usual problems that afflict nutritional epidemiology in particular. The US Dietary Guidelines says it's not recommended that anyone begin drinking or drink more frequently on the basis of health considerations. The WHO says there's no merit in promoting alcohol consumption as a preventive strategy. And so in closing, alcohol may be a source of enjoyment for many, and it's clearly also a source of misery for many, but it's not a health tonic, and it certainly does not qualify for any criteria that might suggest it as a preventive agent, either in a clinical or in a public health context. Thank you very much.